Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is a great series, I think. It's the series on the Book of Luke, and we're studying this series in the months of April, May, and June of 2015. This is lesson number 4 in that series for April 25 of 2015. Entitled The Call to Discipleship. Now, does that refer to just the 12 in Jesus' day, or is he still calling disciples? I guess that's one of the questions we're going to have to deal with, isn't it? But as usual, we hope that you've got your Bible handy, because we're going to ask you to look at some of these verses. We want to make sure that you want you to be sure that we're quoting them accurately, whatever language you're looking at. And we'd like to begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, as usual, we claim your presence among us. We thank you for your word, which we now take in hand as we look at some of the details of your life lived here so many years ago. We have such a benefit to be able to not only read Scripture comfortably in our own language and in English, so many different translations, to get every nuance from the original language, and some of us know how to read those languages. We thank you also for all those who read in other languages that can share and help us to try to understand. We thank you for the writings of Ellen White that has illuminated so many of these passages, and may now we grasp the great truths which are hidden here for us, as our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. What does it mean to be a disciple?
A follower and a pupil?
A follower, a student. Yeah. Some people would want to know what the difference, what the relationship is between disciple and discipline. Are they related?
Implies that there's some teaching to
some teaching to be done. Okay. Well, the disciples in Jesus' day, who were they? What kind of people were they? How did they respond? Apparently Jesus called them in various ways. We're going to look at some of those. What do you think they had in mind when Jesus called them? What do you think they thought they were going to do?
They thought they were being called to join the cabinet of the new president of the country.
Yeah, the new king. We are going to rule Judah and Galilee. Well,
and hopefully the rest of the world.
Yeah. In light of that idea, that question, is Jesus still calling disciples?
That's what we're supposed to be, isn't it?
We're supposed to be, okay.
Why would these fishermen think that they were going to end up being the leaders of this new world power?
I think they recognized that they were attached to someone who had incredible capacity to do all kinds of things. I mean, what would you think? We're gonna get to this, but think about someone who says, "Okay, I want you to go out and preach in these villages over here, and I'm going to give you the power to cleanse the leopards, cast out demons, raise people from the dead, and preach the gospel." You said, okay, off we go. I mean, you know, you got to, if you're going to be accept an assignment like that, you got to recognize what's going on here.
It would catch your attention.
It would get your attention. There's some interesting comments about that from Ellen White. I'd like to read one of them. Jesus chose unlearned fishermen because they had not been schooled in the traditions and erroneous customs of their time. What does that tell us?
Maybe there were some wrong things being taught.
Some wrong things being taught?
How can that be? What wrong things is she talking about? They weren't they part of their culture? And
well, that's exactly what we were just talking about. They were sure that when the Messiah came, hey, he was going to rule them. He was going to throw out the Romans. They were going to be a military group.
But couldn't you say that most, not all, but most of these disciples, they were part of the lower strata of society as it then was, but they were practical laboring men, and they're usually fairly adaptable.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the most important things to get out of that first sentence there is that for us as human beings, it's very often much more difficult to unlearn something which we've attached ourselves to, some idea that we sort of believe in, than it is to learn a new idea, assuming that the new idea is not inconsistent with what we already believe.
You're certainly not talking about us. You're talking about these...
Nothing like that happens today. It was 2,000 years ago.
Yeah. We don't have to unlearn anything, do we?
There's a lot of nonsense being taught in the name of religion. Well, going on, they were men of native ability. These weren't people without any skills. And they were humble and teachable. And maybe that's the most important point of all. Men whom he could educate for his work. In the common walks of life, there is many a man, and woman too, as I might add, patiently treading the round of daily toil, unconscious that he or she possesses powers which, if called into action, would raise him to an equality with the world's most honored men. What does that tell you? The touch of a skillful hand is needed to arouse those dormant faculties. It was such men that Jesus called to be his co-laborers, and he gave them the advantage of association with himself, and that's what I was talking about a moment ago. Never had the world's great men such a teacher, and I hope none of us would have any argument with that. When the disciples came forth from the Savior's training, they were no longer ignorant and uncultured. They had become like him in mind and character, and men took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. And I'd like to just note that point. Where does that idea come from, that men took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus? Do you remember?
Acts 4,
and for some reason
Acts 4:13 to be specific.
Yeah, I put it right up there on the screen. Look at this. Peter and John were arraigned before the Sanhedrin. Now, who were the Sanhedrin?
It was the basic the ruling body of the Jewish religion.
This was the Congress of the Jews in those days. They were the leading scholars. They were the experts. They were the intelligentsia. Okay. Reading, the members of the council were amazed to see how bold Peter and John were and to learn that they were ordinary men of no education. So, in other words, no education means what?
No education from the Pharisees and Sadducees.
They didn't get their education from the Pharisees and the Sadducees.
What was meant by bold here? I'm sure there were lots of bold people. Is this bold about religious things or an understanding of...
They had a confidence.
Remember that this same Peter in the house of Caiaphas had denied three times that he even knew Jesus. When a woman just came and said, you sound like him. Oh, no, cussing and swearing. No, I don't even know this guy. So I think he's changed. They stood up. If we had time, I would go back and he just pointed right at them and he said, this Jesus whom you killed. I mean, how bold do you need to be? He just put it right like that. And the conclusion, they realized then that they had been companions of Jesus.
There was sure a dramatic change between that time and, as you said, even Crucifixion Week, mm-hmm. where they were fighting amongst themselves in the upper room over who was going to be first in the kingdom.
I hesitate to say they had the character of Jesus, though.
Well, I've never supposed seen to have it.
Yeah, I don't.
But it took the crucifixion to really get them to focus on what was really happening.
Yeah.
That was the difference.
What that means is when we say had the character of Jesus, we mean that they spent so much time with him, walking with him, talking with him, observing him, listening to him, etc., and watching him do all the stuff he did, that they just sort of absorbed him. And that's what we're supposed to do. Well, elsewhere, Ellen White says, that, by the way, was from Desire of Ages, page 250, paragraph 1. This is now from Desire of Ages 251, paragraph 1, so the next page. God takes men as they are and educates them for his service if they will yield themselves to him. So what's our job?
To learn.
Yeah.
Listen.
To say, yes, come on in.
That's called obedience.
Yeah. The Spirit of God received into the soul will quicken all its faculties. Under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, Jim, there's your Holy Spirit, the mind that is devoted unreservedly to God develops harmoniously and is strengthened to comprehend and fulfill the requirements of God. The weak, vacillating character becomes changed to one of strength and steadfastness. There's your boldness. Continual devotion establishes so close a relation between Jesus and his disciple that the Christian becomes like him in mind and character. Exactly the same words that she said in the previous page. Through a connection with Christ, he will have clearer and broader views. His discernment will be more penetrative, his judgment better balanced. He who longs to be of service to Christ is so quickened by the life-giving power of the Son of Righteousness that he is enabled to bear much fruit to the glory of God. Desire of Ages, again, 250, paragraph 1.
251.
I'm sorry, 251, paragraph 1. Thank you. Now try to imagine the scene we're talking about here. The fisherman had worked all night, and what happened?
Nothing.
They caught nothing. Now these are people who had been accustomed to, I mean, their life work was fishing on the Sea of Galilee. They had spent the entire life, we're talking about Peter, Andrew, James, and John, and probably some helpers, and I think James and John's father was there, etc. And they had fished all night, and they caught nothing. Now remember, in those days, they had big, heavy nets that they would put down in, and these things are made out of like brown rope with, I mean, twine, so it's pretty tough, clearly visible in the clear waters of the Sea of Galilee, okay? Clearly visible.
So the fish would see them.
So the fish would see them. So you put them out at night so when the fish can't see them, and then you pull it up when the fishes aren't expecting, you aren't expecting it, and you hope to catch some in a big net. So what happens here? Jesus comes along with a whole crowd of people following him, and things are getting so crowded, he's being pushed into the water, basically. People want to get to him. And so he steps back a few steps and into the boat, into Peter's boat. And he says, pull off a little ways from the shore. And so now he's speaking basically to an amphitheater of people there, and he's giving his lessons and so forth. And then it gets to be later in the day, bright sunshine, sunshine shining into the clear waters of the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus says, now what was Jesus' business? He was a carpenter. He wasn't a fisherman. He was a carpenter. He says to the four fishermen, pull out the ways a little ways and cast your nets into the water. Now, four fishermen are listening to him there. And they're saying, excuse me?
We do have to remember that these folks had known Jesus for quite some time, and they had seen some of his miracles.
Yeah. But they never seen him catch a whole net full of fish before.
Yeah. In the broad daylight.
Broad daylight, right. So, what happens? In the middle of the day, clear waters, push the boat out further to the deep water, and you and your partners let down your nets for a catch, Jesus says. Surely to Peter and Andrew, this seemed like a completely foolish exercise. But they had come to trust the words of Jesus, and so they did what he said. As a result, the nets were so full, they had to ask James and John to bring their boat, and both boats were so full of fish that they were about to sink. That was a lot of fish in the middle of the day with visible nets. Peter said, depart from me, for I'm a sinful man. What was he really saying?
You have powers that...
Not worthy to be in your presence.
He's just saying, how could I possibly have doubted? How could I possibly have doubted? Right? Now, Isaiah said something similar back in the Old Testament when an angel appeared to him and touched him with a coal. So what do you think actually happened? Did God create or gather all those fish into that spot at exactly that time just to make his point? Or did he happen to know that there was a whole bunch of fish swimming out there right then, and this was the right time to drop your net down?
Now is not the time to quibble.
I think God could have got it out of the air if he wanted to.
Anyone that can speak to the storm and calm it down, and he can sleep, and they have to wake him up, is not...
It wasn't too much at a different time that he, out of 5 loaves and 2 fish, he fed, 5,000 men plus women and children?
Probably 20,000 altogether.
I mean, he did the same thing then. He multiplied the fish.
So now, are these lessons for the disciples to understand that, hey, you can do this too? Or are these lessons demonstrating that I am the Messiah? Only the Messiah could have these kinds of powers.
Unfortunately, even until resurrection morning, they didn't understand, despite all of Jesus' best teaching efforts, who the Messiah was really supposed to be and what he was supposed to do. I mean, we don't have time to go there now, but Luke 18, they're on their way up to Jerusalem for Passover weekend. Jesus is going to be crucified 1 week later. And Jesus takes them aside and says, I need to remind you something. I'm going up here. I'm going to be arrested. The Jewish leaders are going to hand me over to the Gentiles. I'm going to be crucified. I'm going to die. But 3 days later, I'm going to rise from the dead. And they're going, huh? Huh? What's he talking about?
They heard the words, but they didn't understand the meaning. And to this day, the majority of Christendom doesn't understand
it. At this point, they hadn't been called yet, correct?
No.
Well, they were still in their early learning.
Yes. Well, now that's a question. Ellen White sort of implies that these same four disciples all had been down, I don't know whether they're actually all disciples of John the Baptist already, and then had heard the words. But anyway, they had already followed Jesus, some in the past. He worked kind of under the radar in Judea for the next 18 months. And and she says part of the time they were with him and part of the time they were not. So, but during all of that time, none of them were actually officially called as disciples. He's now beginning his Galilean ministry. And it's at the point where he's beginning his Galilean ministry, he says, okay, we're coming near to the end of my ministry and my time. It's time to get serious about training the future leaders who will take over when I'm gone. And so he starts naming them.
But to answer Jay's question as to whether he was showing God or whether, he's still teaching them or unteaching the idea that the Messiah was just going to be an earthly leader.
Do you think Jesus said, he just said to them, from now on you're going to catch men. Do you think they had any idea what he was talking about?
No.
Not them.
Well, fishing is a dangerous occupation. It's profitable when it goes well. You can have the ship destroyed. You can be thrown overboard. You can drown. There's all kinds of things. So what about fishing for men? Is that dangerous too?
Yeah, can be and has been.
You know, I don't know whether I should mention this or not, but there has been an item on the news talking about this terrible group over in the Middle East who's just slaughtering everybody they can possibly slaughter, and just it doesn't seem to matter to them. And this one analyst said, the reason they're doing that is very simple. They believe that we are approaching the end of the world. There's going to be an apocalypse, and the only people who are going to be saved are them. They are the only ones who are going to be saved. There's going to be a battle between Rome and Islam, and they are going to be the only... So the rest of you people, if you don't believe what we believe, you're already dead. So what difference does it make how we treat you?
You're an infidel, and it's okay to lie and everything to infidels.
Yep. Amazing. Amazing. Well, does God ask us to be fishers of men in our day?
Yes.
Does he tell us where to go and how to do it?
Start in your own street.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Now, there were probably, in fact, we know there were other people who wanted to be disciples. But in this case, he specifically chose 11. And Ellen White suggests that, and even the disciples, some of the other disciples, said, man, this Judas guy, he's a good prospect. We better get him into our group here. And he came and wanted to be a part of the group, and Jesus said, well, okay. What do you think? How do you suppose Jesus went about choosing these 12?
Well, if you kind of follow the biblical account, it's kind of like he's walking along and runs into people and just kind of picks them. That's almost the picture you get. Okay, why don't you follow me? And
yeah.
Are we to assume that these are not the only ones that he asked that question to, and there were some that refused? Or now we do understand that, you know, our classic picture is that he's got these 12 little disciples, but he had many, many disciples. but these 12 seem to have been selected in a special way. But when you read their encounters, it's like, you know, he comes along and there's Matthew sitting at his tax table, and Jesus says, okay, let's follow me.
One of my favorite passages in that context is found in Luke 8. Maybe we should go there for a moment. Sometime later, this is the first three verses of Luke 8. Like you said, we're used to seeing the pictures. If you see an artist drawing, it'll be Jesus with his 12 disciples. Okay. Sometime later, Jesus traveled through towns and villages preaching the good news about the kingdom of God. The 12 disciples went with him. Okay, there's our picture. But there's a comma, and it goes on. And so did some women who had been healed of evil spirits and diseases. Mary, who was called Magdalene, the former prostitute, from whom 7 demons had been driven out, and she was also formerly demon-possessed. She's a great one to have in your group, right? Joanna, whose husband Chusa was an officer in Herod's court. I mean, here's a, you know, like a first lady almost. And she's following Jesus around. And Susanna and many other women who used their own resources to help Jesus and his disciples. You think there might have been more women than men?
Well, we mentioned earlier, and we'll talk some more about the 70 or 72 that were sent out.
That comes
so,
later.
So, yeah, there's a big crowd. There's not just the 12 men. There's a lot more.
Yes.
But the 12 disciples later would become apostles. Yeah. I think that's what makes them a little bit different.
Well, and once again, I'm following the lead of Ellen White. She says, Jesus told these 12, okay, you are my special students, and there will be a lot of other people around. It is your job to stay close to me, to form the inner circle.
So did Jesus randomly pick these people out, or was
there... Well, we read about how he picked them out. I mean, what kind of people he...
The verse just before, Luke 6:12. At that time, Jesus went up a hill to pray and spent the whole night there praying to God. When day came, he called the disciples to him and chose 12 of them. So, you know, I have the picture, partly from you, that Jesus, God the Father, the Holy Spirit, discussed maybe the 70, the 80 all together. And which are the ones that the 12 that we should pull out special, or the 11 that we should pull out special?
Exactly.
Went through them one by one.
I'm sure.
So how do people become disciples today? He's not around.
No. Well, I guess the question is, do you think you're called? Do we have any evidence that we're called?
Well, I haven't received any visions in the night.
They didn't receive any visions in the night.
I haven't been sitting at my desk and somebody walked by and said, okay, or...
Do we need...
We prayed last night and decided you're one of the ones we want to be.
Okay. Do we need that?
Christ is not here. We have the Holy Spirit now.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I haven't... You know, how would that...
Well, I think it depends on... We have access to the Scriptures. We're supposed to study it and... reasonable degree of regularity. And
mm-hmm.
So have you been called?
No, but I've known one or two that have.
I thought one of you was going to read the verse from the Bible that should answer that question. Matthew 28. Someone want to read that for us? And I can read it. Matthew 28, 19 and 20. You should quote it by memory.
Do you have it or shall I read it?
Go ahead. You've got it there.
Go then to all people everywhere and make them my disciples. Make everyone my disciples.
Yeah.
Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you, and I will be with you always to the end of the age.
Okay, Jay, is that enough of a call? Jesus himself said it.
Oh, everybody, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Not going to pummel us into submission.
What?
I say he's not going to pummel us into submission.
No.
Offer.
And we mentioned that being a disciple is becoming more like Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And Yoli mentioned that she wasn't like Jesus.
She wasn't including any of the rest
so,
of
them. So,
not completely like Jesus. I'll stand up for you.
So my question is, are some more like Jesus than others? Are there some?
I don't think we should even try to answer that question. I think you know the answer to that question.
Well, no, I kind of have kind of an answer, but
you don't have to go around and prove to 25 people that you're more like Jesus than they are in order to be called.
Well,
get you into trouble.
Get you into lots of trouble.
I guess my follow-up question is, and of course that determines on what is the qualification for being like Jesus, of course, but. Using a classic interpretation of that, I would say that probably there are more people. There are people who are more like Jesus than other people.
Okay.
But how much more, how much less, how much more do you have to be like him to make it in, so to speak, than what?
Is he great on the curve?
If Yoli is correct here and she's less, let's say, than me, what difference does that make?
I don't think it's a question of degree, the way you're saying it. I have a lot of nieces, and some of them, they love to go on mission. They have careers or whatever, but every year they want to go somewhere and do something because they know something they want to share with somebody else. Mm-hmm. Some people are more willing to do that. Other people just hoard what they know and just keep it to themselves. And I wish I was like them, always ready to go and go share with people. That's what I meant when I mean I'm not like, no way.
I think it's one thing to give your heart to God, which would cover a lot of us, as against somebody like Billy Graham, who toured the world running big things. I mean, there's a real difference. There was a man that was called, and there's been others like him, you know that.
Well, I'm not sure. I might be incorrect, but I'm not sure that somebody like that is, despite the credibility that Mr. Graham has, I don't know. I just question whether somebody who isn't like that is less of a disciple.
Yeah.
We have different ways.
Yeah. Some people are gifted along certain lines.
Yeah, exactly. Clearly, we have different gifts. I mean, Paul says that very clearly in Ephesians and Corinthians and so forth.
Let's suppose I'm not as much like Jesus as Yoli is.
Well, now, but you see, I think you're asking the wrong question. Jesus maybe Jesus has chosen you to be a teacher. Jesus has told Yoli to do something different. Jesus has chosen me to do something different. If we exercise the talents which he has given us in doing what he wants us to do, then I would say we're called as his disciples.
Well, but we're talking about talents here rather than being like Jesus. Is it possible for some to be more like Jesus than others? And if I'm not as much like Jesus as Yoli, does that really make much of a difference?
Okay, let me put it to you in a tough way. Did any of these disciples have any idea that Jesus was calling them to be martyrs?
At the beginning, no. I don't think they had a clue.
Almost every one of them, including Jesus himself, ended up being martyred. far as we know, the only one who didn't end up being a martyr was the Apostle John. So what do you think of Jesus? Come on, follow me. I'm training a bunch of martyrs.
Well, he didn't mention that.
Well, but he warned them. He did warn them later on.
Yeah. Well, later later in the experience, and especially after Jesus leaves and goes back to heaven, we tend to call them apostles. What's the difference between an apostle and a disciple?
Disciple is a beginner, and the other one is an ambassador.
Okay.
Also, they had direct contact with Jesus, isn't it, an apostle? Mm-hmm. Or a witness that others...
Well, the disciple specifically means a learner.
Right.
A learner. And an apostle is one who, literally the Greek means one who's sent out, and it's really the word for ambassador.
Okay. Yeah.
So, presumably after they had received their training, God says, okay, now I'm sending you out as ambassadors. So, you could be a disciple and an apostle, you could be a disciple but not an ambassador, not an apostle, and a lot of people were apostles and not disciples, including
Paul.
Us.
Paul,
yeah.
Specifically.
Well, you know, Jesus leaving Judas out of the picture, an incredible group of guys. I mean, a bunch of fishermen, a tax collector, a zealot. What was a zealot?
Well, the guerrilla of the day.
Yeah, he was one who was absolutely determined to overthrow the Roman government, alongside the tax collector who was working for the Roman government. I mean, he says, come on, guys, let's all be together here. You know, you just...
Imagine the conversation.
Yeah, exactly. And a doubter. Wow. Well, they were trained as ambassadors. And I read once again, this is from Desire of Ages 293, a little while later in the story. While Jesus was preparing the disciples for their ordination, what's an ordination?
Ceremony, setting them aside.
Yeah.
Some kind of ceremony. We don't know exactly what he did, but setting them aside to do what he had chosen them to do. One who had not been summoned urged his presence among them. It was Judas Iscariot, a man who professed to be a follower of Christ. He now came forward soliciting a place in this inner circle of disciples. With great earnestness and apparent sincerity, he declared, Master, I will follow thee whithersoever thou goest. Jesus neither repulsed nor welcomed him, but uttered only the mournful words, The foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of God hath not where to lay his head. Matthew 8:19-20. Judas believed Jesus to be the Messiah. And by joining the... Now, that's interesting because the other disciples, I mean, many times it talks about the whole group. Ellen White seems to suggest, and the Bible seems to suggest, that none of them had figured out he was the Messiah. But she says, Judas believed him to be the Messiah, and by joining the apostles, he hoped to secure a high position in the new kingdom. This hope Jesus designed to cut off by the statement of his poverty. Desire of Ages 293, paragraph 2. And then one more from... that same book, page 294. God takes men as they are. Okay? Jay, you were very concerned about whether you're qualified. God takes men as they are, with the human elements in their character, and trains them for his service, if they will be disciplined and learn of him. They are not chosen because they are perfect. By the way, if God waited for us to be perfect, to be chosen, how many would be chosen?
None.
Okay? But notwithstanding their imperfections, that through the knowledge and practice of the truth, through the grace of Christ, they may become transformed into his image.
I learned the Bible in French first. Mm-hmm. And before Jesus said those words, like the, you know, mm-hmm. that you just mentioned, it mentioned the person he spoke with as a scribe, not as Judas.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I think, I suspect there were a number of times where people came up to him and Jesus, I want to be a part of your disciples. And he had to say something like this, probably to a lot of different people. I mean, you know, if you were there right after he'd just fed 20,000 people with a fish or something,
yeah.
I mean, it sounded like the whole crowd wanted to be part of his disciples. Until he started talking about eating his flesh and drinking his blood.
They still didn't get it.
Yeah. Well, the most important thing, and one of the characteristics we read about in Matthew 18 about the followers of Jesus is it's supposed to be childlike. Remember, he called the child. What's the most important characteristic of a child?
Teachable.
Not all children are teachable, but yeah, they should be. Anything else?
The potential to grow.
The potential to grow. And Jesus grew. How did Jesus grow? Luke 2:52. Mentally, spiritually, socially, physically.
They can also be very trusting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They have kind of a trust, unless that's violated. They have kind of a natural trust as a rule of parents and adults and leaders. And
we know by carefully doing what we call a harmony, by looking at all the four Gospels and putting them together, try to fit them together chronologically, that Jesus actually sent, during that year, Jesus actually sent these disciples out three different times to do circuits around, covering all of Galilee, preaching and healing and teaching. And he just said specifically in one place to do what? Cleanse the lepers, heal the sick, raise people from the dead. Do you think any of these disciples actually raised people from the dead? He told them, he was giving them the power to do that.
If they did, how come it's not recorded in the Gospels? Yes.
Well, that's the question.
I was thinking about that, and I think it's because the Gospels are not about the disciples. Mm-hmm. They're about God.
Yeah, that's part of it. I think there's another part of it. I think they did a lot of it. And the only reportings of raising from the dead and cleansing the lepers that get reported are the ones that led to some kind of controversy with the Jewish leaders. Why would that be? I mean, think about it. Jesus could have walked around Galilee and Judea and said, I'm not going to let anybody die here. Raise everybody. He didn't do that. Why not? This was a teaching mission. His goal wasn't to see how many people he could raise from the dead. His goal was to use whatever teachings and raisings from the dead and healings the lepers, of whatever ones he chose appropriately to use as a means to say to his disciples particularly, okay, this is what God is like, this is what you need to learn how to do, and so forth. Amazing.
He didn't want rice followers or fish followers.
No. Another comment, did each of these disciples have power to actually cleanse lepers and raise people from the dead? Ellen White says in the book Christ's Object Lessons, page 333, as the will of man cooperates with the will of God, it becomes omnipotent. Wow. How does that work? Whatever is to be done at his command may be accomplished in his strength. All his biddings are enablings. Okay, so how do we do that? Any of you have had the experience of being omnipotent recently?
No.
Well, it would be easier to take confidence in this promise if you knew what the bidding was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's the hard part. Mm-hmm. It would seem to me, now maybe not, maybe I haven't received any real big bids. Maybe if I had received some big bids and I looked at them.
I see.
You know, but how do you know whether you're receiving any bids?
Well, Jesus said to the 12 there, he sent them out to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. Ellen White says that healing and teaching are never to be separated. How well are we doing at that? I would just have to tell you my one experience that really, I think, deals with that. I was a student at Johns Hopkins University for almost a year, taking an MPH degree after I'd spent some time in Africa, came back and did that, and then went back to Africa. And during that time, I don't have time to go into all the details, but we attended a small church, a small Adventist church there, and we had a man who was really on fire as the pastor. And we had a doctor who came there and said, I would like to try an experiment. I would like to spend half my time working with the church and the church and the conference will give me half of a minister's salary, and the other half of my time I will see patients and get money from doing that, and let's see what happens. And I can tell you that church was on fire. In a period of 9 or 10 months, the membership like doubled. There were programs going almost every night of the week. There was this was back in the, you know, in the early 70s. There were stop smoking plans. There was exercise classes. There was cooking classes, and we had people on a waiting list to get into those classes in our church. That says something. Well, salvation means healing. So healing of the body is supposed to go along with the healing of the soul and the mind, just as we recognize that sin under Satan's domination has captured and ruined the human race. Christians must escape fully and completely from that control and place their total commitment on the side of Jesus Christ. Nothing is to stand between us and our Savior. Then Jesus told them something else interesting when he sent them out. He said, don't take anything with you on your journey. Why did he say that? He goes on to say, you know, if you're doing your job well, you should be paid for what you do. Or you should be taken care of at least. He said, go into a village. If they welcome you and want to hear what you have to say, fine. If they don't, shake the dust off your feet and go somewhere else. Does that sound like a good way to do things in our day?
Well, it implies they weren't supposed to take anything. They're not supposed to take a knapsack with a sandwich or two, or they're not supposed to
at least enough
take
to
a big tent and cooks and what are we supposed to not take?
I'm sure you're aware that there was a time during the excitement of the before 1844 when Adventists in this country owned the biggest tent that had ever been made up to that point. And they were huge, they jammed those things.
Yeah.
Well, 18 months later, Jesus was approaching near the end of his ministry. It's not safe for him to openly minister in Judea or Galilee. His life was threatened in those places. He's now ministering in Perea. Where's Perea?
East side of Jordan.
The east side of the Jordan River. It's a different government. It's a different one of Herod's sons in charge over there. In fact, by this time, of course, the Romans had taken charge of Judea itself. But this was under Herod over there. And so he's ministering over there. Once in a while, he ventures back real quickly into Judea or Galilee to do something, and then he's back over there. And during that time, he repeats many of his former lessons in the new setting. Now he's talking primarily to whom? What kind of people?
A lot of Gentiles.
A lot of Gentiles. There were a lot of Jews that were expanding into that territory, but there also it was primarily a Gentile territory. By the way, who were the first missionaries sent to that Gentile territory? Do you remember?
The demoniacs.
The demoniacs. The ones from whom he cast out the 2,000 demons, the mob, and into the pigs. Yeah, you can read those stories. But now he, instead of just choosing 12, Jesus chooses 70 or maybe 72. The ancient manuscripts, some say 70 and some say 72. And what does he tell them to do?
Going to the cities, towns, and villages.
Go before me. The places where I'm going to go to work, I want you to go there and work. Before I get there, prepare the field.
What message did they preach?
Yeah.
Was it the right message? Because not even the disciples had the right message until a while after the resurrection.
What we know
about what we are supposed to preach.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, that's a good question. Maybe what they preached was the message. I would. You're talking about the demoniacs here.
I was talking about the 70.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Okay. The demoniacs too.
And the only one who tells us about the 70 is
Luke.
Luke. Why?
He's the only non-Jew.
He's the only non-Jew. In fact, if you go through the Gospels and you're looking for a story about a Samaritan or about a Gentile or in many cases about a woman, you better look in the book of Luke.
Or children.
Or children. Yeah. The other writers, they were too busy with their Jewish hang-ups. I'm not putting them down. I love their writings. But Luke is much broader in his appeal. So much so that the church was so stuck up on this very narrow idea about what the gospel was, who was for and who could be part of it for the first 200-300 years after Jesus was gone, that they didn't want to accept the book of Luke. It was way too lenient, way too liberal.
Well, he wasn't a Jew. No. He hadn't been a disciple.
No.
He hadn't even met Jesus. So how could he possibly write part of the Bible?
Yeah, what about that? Well, we've talked already about the fact that Jesus was followed not just by his 12, but by a lot of others. Immediately after resurrection, there were 120 gathered in the upper room. A little while later, there were 500 out by the Sea of Galilee. And when Peter started preaching, how many were there? They were baptized in one day?
3,000.
3,000 baptized in one day. A little while later, it says there were more than 5,000. And a little bit later, it says many of the Pharisees and many of the priests, if you want to read Acts 15:5 and Acts 6, verse 7, had joined the group. So now what about us, living very far down here near the end of this world's history? What do all this say to us? Look at Luke 10:24. I tell you that many prophets and kings wanted to see what you see, he's talking to his followers, but they could not, and to hear what you hear, but they did not. Not only that, but if you go back way at the end of, almost at the end of the New Testament, 1 Peter 1, verse 12, it says, God revealed to these prophets that their work was not for their own benefit, but for yours, as they spoke about those things which you have now heard from the messengers who announced the good news by the power of the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. These are things which even the angels would like to understand. So do you suppose we're preaching, or we have the privilege potentially of preaching messages that even the angels would like to understand?
That's a pretty powerful concept.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you think the angels by this time, 2015, understand it?
I think so.
They might
but
not have.
But Peter is still saying that quite a few years after Jesus was here and gone.
So if the angels understand this, and we look at this thing in the as we often say in the light of great controversy, when we're waiting for this understanding to come to a complete understanding, if the angels have finally gotten clued in, then most everybody else. So what are we waiting for?
That is the $64 million question. Well, there's a very interesting comment about that found in Revelation 14, verse 4, just before the three angels' messages, which we claim to be our official logo, if you will, or our official goal, or whatever, what we're supposed to be doing. It says, these special people at the end of time are the men and women who have kept themselves pure by not having sexual relations with women. This is not talking about physically sexual, they're talking about spiritual matters. They are virgins, that is, they're pure and true to God. They follow the Lamb wherever he goes. Where did the Lamb go?
To the cross.
To the cross. Do you think maybe God's looking for people who might be willing at least to do that? Not saying they will have to do that, but might be willing to do that even in our day.
But the Lamb also returned to the Father.
Yes,
yeah.
And they will too.
Are there some that might be beheaded, as we've seen in the news recently?
Yeah.
And other forms of horrible death?
Well, it should be clear, I think, from what we've studied this week, that to be a disciple or to be an apostle, for that matter, a person must be a follower of Jesus. Paul said, Galatians 2:20, he was not a disciple, but he was an apostle. Galatians 2:20 says, I have been crucified with Christ. Now that's following pretty closely, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Do we have the privilege of having that kind of experience in our day? Mm-hmm. Look at Luke 9:23. That's a very interesting verse. Jesus is, you know, getting close to the end of his ministry, but it's still a while before. And he said to them all, anyone who wants to come with me must forget self, take up their cross every day and follow me. And the disciples must have went, huh? Now, they were there to follow Jesus to become prime ministers and ministers and cabinet members, etc. And Jesus says, you need to take up your cross. What do you think they understood when he said that?
Nothing.
It was foreign language.
I mean, we think cross, oh yeah, that's what Jesus did. They had no idea of such a thing, and a clue that Jesus was going to die on a cross. I suppose they asked each other, what's he talking about?
But don't we find many times that you can be taught something and you think you've got it, and all of a sudden one day the light comes on and you go,
yeah.
Oh, that's what that meant.
You can be sure that at the point where Jesus said those words, they were not thinking about denying themselves, taking up a cross, following Jesus into a martyrdom. But now we know. There's a famous book called The Cost of Discipleship by Dietrich Bonhoeffer, which has these words, when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. It is the same death every time, death in Jesus Christ, the death of the old man at his call. Only the man who is dead to his own will can follow Christ. That's page 99. Well, has following Christ cost you anything? You're here. You could be somewhere else, going to the movies or something like that.
I would say following Christ has enriched me,
yeah,
rather than cost me something.
Well, it cost Bonhoeffer, didn't it?
Yeah. Ellen White said in the book Sons and Daughters of God, page 69, paragraph 2, lifting the cross cuts away self from the soul and places man where he learns how to bear Christ's burdens. We cannot follow Christ without wearing his yoke, without lifting the cross and bearing it after him. If our will is not in accord with the divine requirements, we are to deny our inclinations, give up our darling desires, and step into Christ's footsteps. By the way, we have quoted quite a few passages from Ellen White here, and if you don't have time to look them all up yourself, our handouts that we use here are available online at our website. That's www.theox.org, not com, but org. We're a nonprofit organization. www.theox.org. Well, if you look at the world today, and unfortunately, if you even look at the Adventist world today, it seems that what we're trying to do is get as much of this world as we possibly can and still not lose heaven. Why are we laughing? How well does that work?
In the final analysis, it really doesn't, does it?
Not very well. Maybe not at all. Can you think of some people in the Bible who gave up almost everything? Or since Bible times, let's pick that. Can you think of some people since Bible times that gave up pretty much everything to follow Jesus?
Well, you quoted from Dietrich Bonhoeffer.
Yeah, he gave up his life. Polycarp, way back in the very early years, and he was the bishop of Smyrna, when he was killed. Well, he survived for a long time. He died as an old man. And we could mention many. Think of all the martyrs. All the people were thrown to the lions, etc., etc. So do we have a clear picture of what it means to deny ourselves, take up our crosses daily, and follow Jesus in the 21st century? Think about this. Why does being a disciple of Jesus here and now require us to do all those things when he's going to take us home to a place where everything is peace and comfortable and all our needs are supplied? We don't have to deny ourselves, or will we? Will there be any self-denial in heaven?
There won't be any self-centered.
Yeah.
Nobody's going to be selfish.
Yeah. In our daily behavior, do we love human approval more than the approval of God? Well, interesting, we stop and think about it, and we're running out of time here, but stop and think about this. Jesus lived his life from very early stage knowing where he's headed. He knows that that cross is where he's going. Would it make a difference to us if we knew where we're headed? Remember up there in the Caesarea Philippi, where with all those pagan temples and so forth surrounding him, Jesus said to his disciples, "Who do men say that I am?" And of course, they had a bunch of different ideas from the Old Testament. And then Jesus said, "Who do you think I am?" Oh, Peter said, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And then not too long after that, he was denying him. How does that happen? Peter recognized that he was a sinful man. And we're running out of time, as I already mentioned. But it's interesting to note that there are certain characteristics that would prevent us from being disciples. I want to mention those just very briefly. One, less than a complete allegiance to Christ. Two, an incomplete submission to his will in our lives. And three, not being willing to forsake all that we have in favor of Christ. We must learn to deny self. That's not easy. We are naturally born sinners. And to be unselfish followers of Jesus, ready to go where he leads, isn't natural for us as human beings, but is what he calls us to and what he chooses to bless us with if we're willing to really partake of it. And you're called to. Our kind and wonderful Father, we thank you for this privilege we had of sharing this good news with many of your friends around the world who might be listening. Thank you for being with us and guiding us. And as we continue on to our next lesson, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.